Good morning. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
What a blessing it is to be in the Lord's house and always be in the presence of the Lord, knowing that we are loved, knowing that we are forgiven, and knowing that we've been made in the image of God. And God desires to have a relationship with each and every one of us. And at this time, are there any announcements? I see a ladies' retreat flyer in there. Did you want to say anything about that?
Actually, I have two items for you. As he said, there is a flyer in the bulletins about a ladies' retreat. We're the Community Connections Network. That's our Methodist Church network for the Ellsworth County area. We've renamed it. We are sponsoring a ladies' retreat. We will have Reverend Billy Blair presenting a program called Holy Happiness, Reaping the Benefits of Joy in Mind, Body, and Spirit. On the form is a place to register. It's all free. Lunch will be provided. We invite you to come, bring a friend, bring three friends, bring as many friends as you would like. The second is a women's Lenten Bible study being put on by Diana Webster. Some of you remember Diana and her family. They attended here some time ago. This is going to be over at the Claflin United Methodist Fellowship Hall. Registration is $5. Her phone number's on it. There's a flyer in the on the bulletin board in the back entryway. Or if you want to give me a call, or if you are in touch with Diane, give her a call. She'd be happy to hear from you. Thanks.
Are there any others? Are there any other announcements? Okay.
Judy has a CAT scan this Tuesday, so we'd appreciate your prayers.
Okay. Judy, you'll be in our thoughts and prayers, and I think we...
Happy to say that Deanna and I are celebrating our 18th wedding anniversary today.
Are there any others?
Yes, we'd like to thank everybody that come and helped us out at the Methodist Men Pancake Feed yesterday. We thank all the volunteers that come and helped, and the congregation that come and eat with us. We had a real good day, but we did have some leftovers. And as usual, we usually don't get rid of all of our eggs, so we got eggs over in the overflow room. And then also there is a few boxes of cooked sausage. If you'd like to take a box of those, most of the people really liked them. And so there's a few boxes there. And so we got a place there for you can make a donation for the eggs and the sausage. So we'd sure like to have you help us out. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And it was wonderful turnout and so many men and women helping also. And it was a real blessing. I'm going to say women, too, because they were, and their hands are tougher than mine. Just saying, when it came to washing dishes. But, yeah, it was a blessing to have them all. Are there any others? Are there any others at all? Okay. Well, if not, I'm going to open us up, so we'll center ourselves before God in prayer, and then we'll have a time for greeting one another. So let us go, Lord. I'm going to ask, as I ask each and every week, to that you'd bow your head, but all bow your heads, but please open up your hands and open up your hearts and minds. Let us go, Lord. Good morning, Lord. We thank you and praise you for this day that you have made, for the opportunity to worship you and praise you and just draw closer to you because you are so worthy. Dear Lord, we know it is true. But I can't always say that I do that. Many times I'm holding on to busyness. Things that I need to do or things that I've left undone. Dear Lord, or anxiety, or brokenness, But dear Lord, we weren't meant to carry it. You didn't make us to carry it. 700 times in your word, you tell us to come to you. So I pray today that we would all allow you to work in our lives, dear Lord. That the Holy Spirit would loosen the grips of things we're so tightly holding on to. And that we would truly surrender it. Lay it at the foot of the cross. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one that is not limited. Now we have empty, open hands to receive the blessings that you have for each one of us. We have empty, open hands to receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, your strength, your power. And gracious God, you have chosen to use us to make a difference in a hurting, in a broken world, that what we have received from you that we can give to others. We can give them that love. We can give them that forgiveness, that grace, that mercy, that strength, that power. I also pray if there's anyone here today that needs a special touch, that they'd feel your presence. Dear Lord, that they'd hear your name. That they would hear their name. That they know that they are loved and forgiven, that you'll never leave nor forsake, that we can always count on you. These things we pray in Jesus' precious name. And all of God's kids say,
Amen.
So let us take this time and greet each other in the love of Christ, please.
Now we're going to say the Apostles' Creed, which is on 880 in your pew Bible or up on the board. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day life everlasting. Amen.
Let us go to the Lord. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. As we reflect on the Apostles' Creed. Dear Lord, for who you are and what you have done. And you tell us to come to you, bring all prayers to you, our joys, our concerns, our supplications. And we do it with thanksgiving. Dear Lord, I thank you for anniversaries. I thank you for church events of people coming together and making a difference. And just that opportunity of fellowship. And what a blessing that is. For all the events of retreats, whether it's ladies' retreat or men's encounter. Dear Lord, we just thank you and praise you. Because we know that you can use all things to draw us closer to you. And I thank you and praise you for that. Just minister to each and every heart. I pray, dear Lord, that whatever we're going through, we know that you are with us. You never leave, you never forsake. Whether it's grieving, whether it's having procedures or taking tests or even waiting for results, you are with us. And we thank you and praise you for loving us so much that, dear Jesus, you paid for our sins. But not only did you defeat sin, but you also defeated death. And because of that, dear Lord, we also have hope. Now, gracious God, I just thank you again as we come before you and as we say the Lord's Prayer together, that by your grace that we live each word. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now we're going to be singing from the hymn, I Come With Joy, hymn number 617. 617. Or on the screen. may be seated. And at this time is a time for the young disciples. And will the young disciples please come forward? Hi. How's it going? Good? All right. Well, today I'm going to talk on a fun topic. You know what I'm going to talk about? Jesus loves us. God loves us. And he loves us so much that he disciplines us. Isn't that exciting? Do you get excited for discipline? Well, maybe it's not called excitement, but maybe a little fear and trembling. But actually, why do we get disciplined? Why do your parents discipline you? Because you might have done something. Yeah, you done something wrong. And then what does it matter that you did something wrong? So you don't grow up to think that that's right. So that we would do the right thing. And so that we could grow in maturity, right? And that's why God disciplines us. He wants us to grow in spiritual maturity. Actually, he wants us to be like who? Yeah, to be like Jesus. That we be more loving, more compassionate, more caring. All right. So when you get disciplined, know that you are loved. God has always loved you. God always will. And then when we get disciplined by our parents, we know it's because they love us and they want the best for us. They don't do it to be mean. They do it because they love us. So how about some prayer and some treats? What do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Is it yeah for the prayer or yeah for the treats?
Yeah for the
treats. It's good to be honest. All right. Well, let's pray. Well, dear Lord, it is a treat to come before your presence and know that we are loved and know that you want the best for us. We thank you for our mommies and daddies and how they love us. And we thank you how you love us. You want the best for us. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. All right. Cookies, all right. Yeah, one, two is good. Oh, one for, oh, you're doing it for someone else. That's great. Now, at this time, we'll have our praise hymn, Open the Eyes of My Heart, and you'll see that on the screen. Thank you. Not this time is the time as we receive our offering. Would the ushers please come forward? Let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you today. We ask that you would bless this offering we're about to receive, because we know that all good things come from heaven above. Dear Lord, we thank you, because we know that you're going to bless this offering and it's going to make a difference in the world. Dear Lord, that people will hear, people will see of your love, of your grace, of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, of his life, death, and resurrection. Dear Lord, we also ask that you would bless each and every one here today. Bless those that are able to give financially. Bless those for their time, for their service, for their prayers and presence. And it is such a blessing to be in ministry with you. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Today comes from Hebrews 12, 5 through 11. And you have forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as children. My child, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, or heart when you are punished by him. For the Lord disciplines those whom he loves, and chastises every child whom he accepts. Endure trials for the sake of discipline. God is treating you as children, for what child is there whom a parent does not discipline? If you do not have that discipline in which all children share, then you are illegitimate and not his children. Moreover, we have human parents to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not be even more willing to be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they discipline us for a short time, as seemed best to them. But he disciplines us for our good, in order that we may share his holiness. Now, discipline always seems painful rather than pleasant at the time, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for this time. I just humbly ask that you would give me the words, that they'd be your words and not mine. That we'd have a greater understanding of how you love us when you correct us. Because, dear Lord, you want the best for us. You want us to be like your son. And just a little while ago, we sang, "Open the eyes of my heart," that we want to see you. And dear Lord, because of your correction, we can see you. I know many times when I sin, my focus, well, all the time when I sin, my focus isn't on you. Dear Lord, I can be self-seeking, self-centered, self-focused, not God-focused. But in that correction, in that discipline, dear Lord, I can see you loving and desiring to restore us. So just minister to each and every one of our hearts today. I thank you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. If you have been privileged to travel to Europe, you may have been shocked to discover how some of the landmark buildings are black on the outside. Centuries of smoke, soot, smog, and dirt have completely defaced their exteriors. But you might see a picture of that building that you visited after you came back, and it is no longer black, and it has been cleaned, completely cleaned. Because centuries of grit and grime has been removed. God does the same thing in our lives. When we get the grime, or when we get the grime of this world on us, God puts us through a cleansing process to be restored. Most of us don't want this kind of God that would allow human hardship. The kind that allowed suffer. Instead, we want the kind of God C.S. Lewis described in The Problem of Pain. We want not so much a father in heaven as a grandfather in heaven. One whose plan for the universe is such that it might be said at the end of each day, a good time was had by all. How shallow, how shallow, how foolish to think that a God who truly loves us will never discipline us. That which makes his love authentic is that he does discipline us, and regularly so. I'm a father and now a grandfather, and I understand what C.S. Lewis was saying. I am totally different with my grandchildren than I was with my children. Actually, when Betty and I got married, Blake was almost 6 years old. And we had grandchildren that was a little older and a little younger than Blake. And he'd see us, how we would treat our grandchildren. And he said, "You don't love me as much as you do them. You treat me differently than you treat them." He picked up pretty quickly. He was right. Because we were his parents, and We knew we were responsible for Blake, and we wanted Blake to grow in his maturity and be the person that God was calling him to be. You know, when I think about that, I think of a comedian once said, it was amazing his father and how much differently he treated the grandchildren. He said, this was the same man that when he grew up, his father would tell him how he had to walk 20 miles uphill to school. And then when he walked home, he had to go another 20 miles uphill. He said it was the very same man that would come in the house when the grandchildren was there and start rattling his pockets and said, wonder who's got some money for you kids today. It is different. But we do not want a Godfather in heaven. We want a Heavenly Father in heaven that loves us and wants the best for us. Yes, there may be correction. There will be correction. There will be discipline. But it's given out of love. We've been hearing about God's love in the last 6 weeks. How God has always loved us and God always will. So what are the reasons for God's discipline in our lives? There are three reasons that we experience God's discipline in our life. Punishment, protection, and purification. God disciplines us for punishment. In Psalm 89:30-32. If his sons forsake my law and do not follow my statutes, if they violate my decrees and fail to keep my commandments, I will punish their sin with a rod, their iniquity with flogging. We see throughout the Old Testament, when someone sinned, that there was punishment. King David would be a very good example. Especially on that night when he probably should have been with the army. During wartime, he was up on the rooftop, channel surfing, if you would. Actually, he knew what channel to go to. He knew about Bathsheba. He knew about what time bedtime or bath time was. Well, we won't talk about the bedtime, but anyway, we know David's sin. We know the sin of adultery. We know the sin of he had Bathsheba's husband killed. The deceit that he had for the whole countryside and the deceit of with Bathsheba. And we know that God told him and shared with him that the sword would come to his home. We know that the child died. We know the rebellion of his sons. God got David's attention, for sure. But I want you to know he continued to bless David in spite of his sin, in spite of his punishment. God even said that David was a man after his own heart. God loved him. God never did stop loving him. Yes, he punished him. And God's discipline is also to protect us. We see in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. God always uses discomfort to protect us. The Apostle Paul was given a thorn in the flesh to keep him humble so he wouldn't become prideful over divine revelations he had received from God. Three different times, Apostle Paul asked God to remove that thorn in his flesh. God did not remove it, but God gave him grace to endure it instead. Gave him grace to endure it instead. Paul was disciplined not for something that he had done, but to keep him from doing something he shouldn't do. So God disciplines us to punish, to protect. And God also disciplines us to purify us. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 10, our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best. But God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in His holiness. Discipline given to children so that they might mature, that they would become the adults that we want them to be. And God disciplines us so that we would be spiritually mature. William F. Buckley, when they asked him what was the most important thing, what helped him the most in his life, and he said that he was taught by suffering, by that pain. He said he learned so much more than he did out of joy, out of success, but out of pain and suffering. You see, God wants to make us like His Son from Romans 8:29. But He uses everything in 8:28, that God can use all things to draw us closer to Him. Can use all things for good. And that good is that we would mature, that we would be like Christ. The reality of God's discipline on our lives. In Hebrews 12, 6 and 8, 6 through 8, because the Lord disciplines those He loves, and He punishes everyone He accepts as a son. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons. For what son is not disciplined by his father? I could say amen on that one. If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons or daughters. The presence of God's discipline proves that we are His sons, that we are His daughters. The punishment is a penalty for sin, but discipline is the training a father gives to his child, that we would be trained up, that we would go the right way. Just as I mentioned on that song in my prayer, open the eyes of my heart when I am being disciplined, even in the pain, even in the suffering, when God seems so far away, I can feel God's presence starting to open my eyes and looking towards Him instead of my circumstances. Because many times those circumstances have led me there because of my choices in my life. I remember one time, it wasn't my father that disciplined me, but it was my mother, and she did it in a unique way. My name is Dennis James Carter, but I think at one time, more than once, my mother said my middle name was Want. Maybe you've heard this. Because your middle name must be Want, because that's all you do is want, 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 want. Am I the only one that has that middle name? Yes, Alice said yes, amen. But I was probably 7 years old, and we went to a dime store, Ben Franklin's dime store. And I saw a car that I just really, really needed. And I didn't know why my mom went there, but it was great. And I whined, and I wanted, 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 and she gave in, and I got that car. And then we went to a friend's house about 10 miles away, and we went there, and it was great to see him, and I was so glad I got that car, you know, because my middle name was Want, 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 Want. And I found out it was a birthday party. And my mom spent that money on me instead of what she intended to. Boy, did I learn from that one. Talk about opening my eyes. I've never asked for that same car since. Thought I'd throw that out there for you. But yeah. The presence of God's discipline proves that we are His children. Because God wants the best for us. He wants us to be like Christ. And the absence of God's discipline proves that we are not His sons or daughters. It says illegitimate. That means that you wouldn't have any rights. We don't want that. We want to be God's kids. We want to be loved. We want to be forgiven. We want to be like Christ. The reaction of God's discipline in our lives. From Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5. And you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when He rebukes you. We can be indifferent to God's disciplines. It says, don't make light of it. Don't blow it off. But consider it. Ask God what is going on. Ask God maybe where you missed the mark. We can be intimidated by God's discipline. It says don't lose heart. Don't be discouraged. Yeah, indifferent isn't the one that we normally go through, but mainly it's intimidated because of our situation, because that we're in. But it tells us not to lose heart. Because this is happening so that we can be corrected, so we can be directed. We can be ignorant about God's discipline. It's hard to be enthusiastic about things that we don't understand. Have any of you ever heard from your parents, this hurts you more than it does me? Four of you, anyway. In the back of my mind, when I heard that, this hurts you more than it does me, it's because I love you that you're receiving this. In the back of my mind, I wanted to say, well, quit loving me so much. I think I did one time, and I think I even got it more than I would have. Wow. We can be instructed by God's discipline. We find that it is possible to be trained by God's discipline to deepen our relationship with God and to grow in love with Him. When we turn away from discipline, we actually turn our back on growth and on love. When we turn away from discipline, we actually turn away from growth and love. The rationale for God's discipline in our lives. We see in verses 9 and 10 of chapter 12. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who discipline us, and we respect them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and life? Our fathers discipline us for a little while as they thought best. But God disciplines us for our good. And it isn't just for a little while. It's for all our lives. That we may share in His holiness. That we would share in His holiness. That we would be set apart. That we would be different. Our human fathers discipline us as it seems best to them. But our Heavenly Father disciplines us as it is best for us. Because He wants the best for us. He wants us to be like Christ. He wants us to be more compassionate, more loving, more caring, more forgiving. Our Heavenly Fathers discipline us for earthly reasons. Our Heavenly Father disciplines us for heavenly reasons. One is for a short time, but the other is for eternal. So it's temporal from our fathers, and it's eternal from our Heavenly Father. The result of God's discipline in our lives, we see in verses 10 through 11. Our fathers discipline us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in His holiness. No discipline seems pleasant in the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and a peace for those that have been trained by it. So the three results from God's discipline in our life is holiness, righteousness, and peace. Because He wants us to receive that holiness. He is holy in that we would be holy, that we would be set apart, that we wouldn't be like the world, but we would be like our Lord and Savior. He also wants us to reflect righteousness. It tells us it produces a harvest of righteousness, that we would be of fruit, that we would have great fruit, that there would be love, there would be joy, there would be peace, there would be patience, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. And He wants us to radiate peace. In Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. It says, bring everything to the Lord. Don't be anxious about anything, but bring all things to the Lord. And when we bring that, the peace of God will transcend us, will come upon us. I've seen it. I've lived it. I've seen others go through great difficulties. But I know they have prayed. I know they have turned to God. And they have such peace that one in this world would say, well, how can they find comfort in that? But it's because of turning to God and having that peace. And in John 15, 1 through 8, and when I look at discipline and this was Jesus talking to the disciples after the Last Supper on the way to Garden of Gethsemane. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does not bear fruit, He prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. And no branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I am him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown in the fire and burned. And if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given to you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. When I think about this discipline, Jesus is saying that He was the true vine and the Father is a gardener. And He cuts off every branch in us that bears no fruit. While every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes so that it will even be more fruitful. When I think of that, I think of a gardener being the closest to the branch when he prunes. So when we are disciplined, God is so close to you because God wants you to bear much fruit, that it glorifies him. So when one is being disciplined, God is so close. God always loved you, and God always will. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you as we reflect on your love and grace, as we reflect on being disciplined. We're about to receive communion. And dear Lord, I know that we will all be coming forward and receiving that bread and taking a cup or dipping it in the cup. And dear Lord, we're reflecting on that we have been forgiven. Yes, we have missed the mark. We have all sinned. But you tell us to come to you, the one that has paid for our sins, the one that desires to restore us, that we can have atonement with God, at one-ment with God because of what Christ has done. So, dear Lord, just minister to each of our hearts. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. I'm going to have my communion stewards come forward. As we prepare the table. We also have gluten-free bread if you would like that too. So please, as they prepare their hands, I just pray that God just continually prepares each one of our hearts as we reflect on God's love, on God's goodness, on God's grace. I'll just have you come to the side, and we will receive communion after you have. And then on that night, Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and said, "This is my body. Take, eat, and do this in remembrance of me." The scripture tells us after the supper, which would have been the third cup, there was four cups because of four promises, and it was the cup of redemption. Jesus took the cup and blessed it. He said, "This is a new covenant, my blood shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Take, drink, and do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your table. It is not our table. It is not the First United Methodist Church of Ellsworth table, but it is your table, dear Lord. Dear Lord, this is an open table and all are invited. Just as God's grace is for all, this communion is all for all. To draw us closer to your love, to your grace, to your forgiveness, and knowing that you are ministering to each one of us. You love us, you forgive us, and you want us to receive it. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. You already received yours, right? Yeah, it's right there. Okay. We didn't want him to miss out, though. We don't want anyone to miss out. Like I said, this is an open table. I'm going to have the ushers come forward, and they're going to model for us. I'm going to have them make their hand like a shape of a cross, and I'll put the bread in it, as we receive God's grace, we want them to receive the bride, the body and the blood of Christ given for you.
God, we thank you and praise you for this sacred holy moment. Continue to minister to our hearts as we reflect on your love, on your grace, on your mercy that you have for all the world, that you have for us. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Now, if you're comfortable standing, I'm going to ask if you would you please stand as we sing the hymn, For All the Saints, verses 1 through 4, and you'll find that on 7:11. We just thank you and praise you. How you love each and every one of us. But dear Lord, you love us too much to leave us right where we are. Through discipline, dear Lord, that we would grow in spiritual maturity. That we would become more like Christ. So dear Lord, I just thank you and praise you. As we reflect on how good you are, how loving you are, and that we would share that love with others. So I send them out in the power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen. God bless you all.